Amen? Amen. It's putting out the fiery darts of the enemy. That's the title. Putting out the fiery darts of the enemy. And we're taking this from the book of Ephesians. Let's go first to the book of Ephesians, chapter 6. Amen. Ephesians chapter 6 from verse 10. Ephesians 6:10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Amen. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having guarded your waists with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Verse 16. Above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. Now let's turn on verse 17. And take the helmet of salvation, the word of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Let's talk to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. I'm going to read from verse 3. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God for pulling down strongholds. Verse 5, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ, and being ready to punish all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord will bless the reading of his word.
Amen.
And give us inspiration and anointing to receive all that he has for us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
This is an interesting passage. Putting out the fiery darts of the enemy. I was a young boy, not even a teenager. I don't think I was up to a teenager during the Nigerian Civil War. And I experienced the war in a sense that the war was not just fought in the battlefield, it was fought in the village. I remember one afternoon, while as a young boy we were playing, and suddenly there was this aircraft that flew. It was the Nigerian aircraft, and keep in mind the Civil War was between Nigeria and Biafra. And so we were the Biafra, okay? And so the Nigerian aircraft flew and suddenly started shooting. And the next thing was noise all over the place. And when bombs were released, they dug big holes. And you see decapitations, you see people's eyes being blown away and all that. We saw all that life. It was tragic. And I know a lot of you remember the Gulf War. The first Gulf War, which was Desert Storm, it was a time when Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait and annexed it, and United Nations and all the world leaders pleaded with him to cease and desist from Kuwait, but he wouldn't pay attention. In fact, he threatened to bring the world to their knees if they interfere with his aggression. And so, about 35 nations, allied nations, came together and led by the United States. So in January 17th of 1991, the war started. They began to bomb and pound Iraq. And it lasted until the 28th of February, if you recall your history very well, of 1991. So for about 42 days, Iraq was pounded. And the Saddam Hussein, who was bragging of bringing the world to its knees, and when missiles started flying from Kuwait, from Saudi Arabia, you know, across the Mediterranean Sea, and the army of Saddam couldn't contain this onslaught. So he surrendered. Now, why did he surrender? Because of the fiery darts, because of the Scud missiles, because of the ballistic missiles with warheads. He never envisaged that that would be the case. Now, keep in mind that he was boasting based on his armory, his armor, his power. And now, when American and allied forces came against him, the power, the armor power that he saw, he couldn't contain. It was greater than his. It was greater than what he thought or expected. So then the war ended, and he lost. Again, in 2003, remember? Second Gulf War, when President Bush went in, and you know the story. Yeah. Those of you who know the story, there were a lot of things about the war. But well, again, Saddam Hussein was asked to surrender his weapons of mass destruction and so on and so forth. Whether they existed or not, that's not what I'm here for. But anyway, at the end of the day, the same Saddam Hussein who was constantly boasting had to bow, and he was defeated. And at this time, not only was he defeated, he wasn't just captured. He ran, right? He ran and actually hid in a hole, in a farmland. You know, he was captured. And I watched this, and a lot of you did. His army. He saw how they surrendered, you know. And prior to that, a lot of noise they were making. Now you go to Libya, it was the same thing. Gaddafi's sons were saying, you just come, your bodies will be everywhere. We will just kill you like rats. And again, when America started pounding Libya, it wasn't too long that they were disarmed. Because of the power of their army. Praise the Lord. They lost the battle. Gaddafi was captured and killed. Now, let's go back to our passage. In Ephesians chapter 6, clearly, the Bible tells us about the devil and what he has. Now, look at verse 16. It says, above all, taking the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. Fiery darts. It's interesting that Paul will use the word fiery darts. Now, we have the word dart, Alright? But that was not what Paul used here. Paul used fiery darts. Not just darts. And Paul was using fiery darts to get across his point to believers on the onslaught of the devil against the church. In fact, last Friday I went to a Christian bookstore in Bowie Town Center I ordered some books, so I went there to get the books. And this book I ordered on the 14th of February. And they told me it was going to take between 7 to 10 days. So I went there, and it didn't come. So I went back. So Friday, I went back the second time because it was way past 14 days. So when I got there, as soon as I got there, I looked at the door and I said, "Store closing." Okay? So when I say "store closing," I didn't understand until I asked what it is. And they said, "Well, this store is going to close permanently. Not just that store, but all the Christian bookstores." The name Christian bookstore, not all Christian bookstores. There's some Christian Family Bookstore. That's the name of the bookstore. And Christian Family Bookstore was in Laurel.
Yes.
Yeah. So we went to Laurel then, but it had closed many years ago. Exactly. So now Christian Family Bookstore in Bowie is closing, and not just that, but all Christian Family bookstores all over are closing. Now, this is an onslaught against the church.
Yes.
We may not understand what is going on, but the devil is firing his darts against us as believers. Praise the Lord. Now, Satan has some power. And here, Paul is trying to let us know. He says, "Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, and put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil." Paul is not missing words here to educate us and let us know that the devil has some wild powers. There's no doubt about it. And that's why we're encouraged to put on the whole armor. Not some, but the whole armor of God. Amen? Now put on the whole armor. In verse 16, which I want us to zero into, Paul goes on to say, above all, taking the shield of what? Faith. Shield of faith. Taking the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. Paul is telling us that the enemy is going to throw fiery darts, not darts, but fiery darts at us. And because he's going to throw fiery darts at us, we need to take the shield of faith. You know what shield is? Shield is that which you use to protect yourself. Okay? It's a bulletproof. The military will wear it to protect themselves. So Paul is saying, take this shield of faith with which you will be able to do what? To
quench.
Quench the fiery darts of the enemy. Why quench? Here is the thing. The fiery darts, let's look at the arrow, the missile. Now this missile has fire beam, okay? It's combustive. Actually, the original Greek word uses the word combustion. So this weaver beam arrow that Paul is talking talking about here has combustive tendency. It has fire. So that when it goes, the arrow is thrown, it has some fire on it. So that when it burns, it disengages and it burns. It doesn't just kill, but it burns. So Paul is saying it is a fiery dart. And so when the enemy throws these fiery darts, we have to protect ourselves and quench it. Now let's go back to the Gulf War. When America and allied forces stationed in Saudi Arabia, Israel became a target of Saddam Hussein. So Saddam Hussein would launch Scud missiles in order to destroy Israel, including Saudi Arabia. But America had to station anti-Scud missiles. You remember that? So when these missiles are fired, immediately the anti-Scud missiles will be released and quickly goes to intercept the Scud missile that is fired on air, takes it and sends it to the sea, and releases it, diverts it to the sea, so that the Scud missile will not hit its target. Praise the Lord. So the Bible is telling us here that we should take on the armor, the full armor, and the shield of faith, with which when the enemy throws his Scud missile, what happens? When it will, it will intercept it, deflect it, and neutralize it. Shield of what? Faith. Well, you know, the enemy, this is not physical, because the Bible says that the weapons we fight with are not carnal, but they are mighty through God, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And they pull down what?
Strongholds.
Strongholds. So here's the thing. When the devil throws this, his river beam, fiery darts at us, you have to understand that the weapons that we fight with, according to 2 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 4, for the weapons we fight with of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through who? And what did they do? They pull down the strongholds, the Scud missile, that which the enemy is throwing at you. So we have weapons that neutralizes the onslaught of the enemy against us. So we have to put it on. We are encouraged to put it on. If you don't put on your bulletproof, when the enemy strikes, it gets at you. So the Bible, Paul is saying, please put on the whole, not some, but put on the whole armor of God, so that you will be able to do what? To withstand. See? Divine ability. So that you will be able to withstand against the wild. He is wild. Amen. The enemy doesn't know boundaries. He is wild. Amen. You have to understand that he's wild. So for you to overcome and defeat him, you have to put on the whole armor of God and be ready to wait for him. Because so that when he throws his arrow, when he throws his fairy darts that has combustive burning warhead, what you got in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 4, what we got will be able to withstand it. And then, like the anti-scout missile, we'll be able to intercept it and pull it down. Take it to the sea, neutralize it, so that it will not have effect on you.
Amen. Amen.
Are you following what I'm saying?
Yes.
Yes, the devil has power, but you've got more power than that of the devil.
Yes.
Through God. Through Christ. So please don't go walking like somebody who is powerless, because the power that you have is not based on your natural power. You know, Tim and I play some games from time to time, and we do wrestling. And sometimes, you know, I hit him, he hits me, and he hits very hard. Really hard, you know. And sometimes the mom will say, no, it's just a joke, don't hit too hard. But, you know, I got some experience. So we will be, you know, pushing each other, trying to see who will win. And I'm skilled, you know, I have experience, right? So he's taller, he thinks he has more muscles. Yeah, he's looking at this old man. Yeah, so he's trying to do his best, but I use my skill and boom, he goes down and he's looking at me. How many people that experience? Praise the Lord. Experience. Amen. See, the devil thinks that he can, but you see, the Bible tells us that there is something we have, and that which we have is greater than that of the devil.
Amen.
We have a more superior power, a more superior warhead.
Amen.
You see, Saddam Hussein was boasting of his military might. In fact, he terrorized the people. The nations begged him. They said, well, now, you guys will be on your knees. You'll be begging me. And I remember vividly where George Bush then was saying, they even offered to compensate him, said, no, because of the oil of Kuwait. You know, but when superior power started, when the warheads started flying, my God, this guy didn't believe. He had no idea of what he was faced. And he surrendered in 42 days. Praise the Lord. Though we walk in the flesh, but we do not walk after the flesh. No. Hallelujah. We fight an enemy. The Bible says your adversary, calls him an adversary. Who is your adversary? Satan is your adversary. He fires his missiles always at us. And he does this through many ways. So what are those missiles that he fires at us? Why did Paul use the term fiery darts? Not just darts, not missile only, or arrows, but fiery darts. Why did you do that? Why? Think about it. So, the devil has so many ways and so many schemes, as the Bible says, which he uses in trying to get at us. He wants to render us defenseless. How does he do that? Number one, he uses worry and anxiety. Note this. Worry and anxiety. Jesus said, don't worry about tomorrow. In Matthew chapter 6. He said, don't worry about tomorrow, because tomorrow will take care of itself. He says, why do you have to worry? By worrying, is it going to add anything good to you? No. Paul says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and thanksgiving and supplication, prayer, supplication, and thanksgiving, let your request be made known to. Don't worry. But wait a minute. In this room this morning, Don't show your hand. How many of you are worried? Worried about tomorrow? Worried about the future? Worried about what is going to happen? Worried about what is not going to happen? Worried about your children? Worried about your academics? Worried about food? Worried about your bills? There's so much worry. This is one of the very attacks of the enemy, to cause you to worry. And in the process of worrying, what happens? Doubt sets in. As you are worrying, you become defenseless. As you're worrying, your physical body is worn out as you're worrying. He uses it as an instrument against you. Because keep in mind, the Bible says, for the weapons of our warfare are not what cannot. This is not something that he comes and shoots his fairy dart and say, where are you? Like the army of the Allied forces and that of Iraq. No, it's not. Where are you? Where's the enemy? It's not the kind of civil war between Nigeria and Biafra. That's not the kind of. There is war going on constantly in our lives. There is a battle going on right now in your life. And the devil is your enemy and he's fighting. He's fighting. Let me tell you, sometimes I do worry myself. Make no mistake about it. And I'm sure that the word that came to us this morning is saying, my son, just what I told you, I'm going to do it. Do you know, sometimes I'm wondering, God, are you really going to do it or not? Because I'm human. We're all human, praise the Lord. Amen. That's why some of you are sleeping this morning, because you are human too. If you're sleeping and you know you say amen, praise the Lord. I come you. Amen. So he uses anxiety. Anxiety, how does that work? How does that happen? You see that you go to, something is happening in your body and suddenly you go to the doctor and they do the scan and all that, tests and all that, and the doctor's face changes and immediately, your heart is beeping. Doctor, what is it? And immediately you forget what the word of God says. You forgot what the word of God says. And your heart is beeping. It's pumping. And it's racing. And at that point, if anybody checks your blood pressure, boom, it goes up. Nothing is wrong with you. It's just your mind. And then the doctor comes back and says, oh, don't worry, there's nothing. Oh, thank God. And your blood pressure comes down. Now, if the doctor turns around and says, this is not looking good, it goes back up. And not only does it go back up, you begin to dwell on it. But that is the fairy dirt that the enemy is bringing against you. But you see, you have to put on the shield of faith. And what is the shield of faith? The Bible tells us what the shield of faith is. It says it is the word of God. The word of God that says in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24, it says, by his strength you were healed. That's a shield of faith. That's your anti-scorpion. That's what you use. But when the devil brings his own, then you don't listen, don't wait. Now, there must be counter attack. The devil attacks you. Don't stay there. Don't wait. I know the initial reaction will be for you to panic. It's natural. But don't just stay there. Use the word of God. By his stripes, I am what? Healed. That is your shield of faith. With which you will quench. You see, the Bible says, you will quench the fairy darts that the enemy has thrown, which is to tell you that this is happening to you, that is happening to you, that is the fairy darts. Don't stop there. Go, move forward, and use the Job had an encounter. Everything Job lost. The only thing that was left for Job was his wife. In fact, in Job chapter 2, verse 9, the wife said to him, "What are you still doing here? Curse God and do what? Carry dice. What are you still? What is left for you? There is no more hope for you. You curse God and die." Hallelujah. But you know what Job said? Job said in chapter 19, he said, "Look, I know that my Redeemer, you see, I understand that after this flesh has been eaten up by worms, he says, my eyes shall see the Lord. My eyes shall see the salvation of the Lord." You know what that means? That is, it's shield of faith.
Yes.
Yes. Job understood. He says, this flesh, yes, right now is eaten up by worms. That is the very dust that the enemy is throwing at me. But let me tell you, my shield of faith, I am going to put it on. It is the word of God. And the word of God says, let me tell it to you, madam, Mrs. Job, hear me. These eyes will see the salvation of the Lord. Why? Because I know that my Redeemer lives.
Yes. Hallelujah.
So Job didn't stop at what his wife said. He went forward, used the word of God. And we know the end of the story. Job was restored. Not only was his body restored, his wealth was restored. Praise the name of the Lord. Use the word of God. It is the weapon that we have. Use it. Use it. You know, we live in a time and age and culture that everything that goes bad, somebody is responsible. Something is not going well. Oh, my mother and oh, my brother and my sister and oh, my uncle, my village, this and that, you know. And we create unnecessary panic for ourselves. Somebody is responsible for all our troubles. Fairy dance. Fairy dance. And in fact, things become tougher. But the weapons of our warfare, the Bible says, and all can obey the Almighty true God. And what is your weapon? Isaiah chapter 54, verse 17. It says, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. And any man that shall rise against you in judgment is what? That is your weapon. It's your weapon. Praise the name of the Lord. So you go home, and as you go to Nigeria, and you go to Ghana, or you go to wherever you go, and everybody says, oh, don't do this, don't do that. Be careful. As he told me, oh, just be careful. You know, we saw one black jeep with three people inside. They stopped here and they went back. And the following day, we saw the same jeep with three people inside. They stopped and they went back. So I'm just telling you, I don't want to put fear in you. And then the first thing is, I have to go to the bathroom. Praise the Lord. Maybe kidnappers, maybe armed robbers. It could be true. What about the word of God? What about the word of God when the Syrian army came? I mean, the soldiers were everywhere. But the man of God said, you know what? You are going to be blind. What about they being blind? Use the word of God. And Jesus said, let it be unto you according to your what?
Faith.
According to your faith. Believe on the Lord your God and you will be established. Believe on his prophet and you will prosper. Go by the word of God.
Amen.
Go by what God says.
Amen.
Not what man says, but what God says.
Amen.
They tell you, well, you know, this is gene. Is generational, is from you inherited it, is from yourself. Come on now. You are redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ, the blood of the new covenant. Is that not what we just expressed this morning? The blood of the new. Why are you still meddling with the old blood? Come on, take on the blood of the new covenant. The Bible says we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word. Stop panicking.
Hallelujah.
Apply the word of God in your life in order for you to quench the fiery darts of the enemy that is throwing at you. Let me tell you, he's not going to stop throwing them. The Bible didn't promise us that he's going to stop throwing. He won't. In fact, if he stops, he's no longer a bad devil. And you know, he can never be a good devil. Praise the Lord. Put on the shield of faith so that you will overcome. Amen.
Amen.
Anxiety, fear, anger. You know, the Bible said, be angry but sin not, according to Ephesians verse 4, chapter 4, verse 26. Anger. He uses that to provoke you. And this is very common. Anger. Somebody says something, you begin to interpret. Let me tell you what I think you are saying. You have no right to tell me what I think I'm thinking, or what you think I'm thinking. You don't have that. You know why? You're not in my head. Don't assume. It's an assumption. And the devil uses assumption a lot. I know what you're thinking. How do you know? Are you God? Are you following what I'm saying?
Yes.
And watch those statements. The moment you hear those statements, the next thing that will lead is anger. It's confrontation. I know what you're thinking. I know why. You know you don't. Don't assume. Praise the Lord. So the devil, the enemy, uses anger as a fiery dart to escalate situations. And before you know it, you enter into an argument, unnecessary argument. Whether it be husband and wife or children, you enter into an unnecessary argument. But you know what the Bible says? Love one another. Love one another deeply. For love does not count wrong. Love is forgiving. Even if actually you know, you truly know what he's thinking. So what? You know what the Bible says? Love one another deeply. Forgive one another. Where is forgiveness? You see, when you use stuff like this, when you use the word of God, which I will encourage us to, because for every fiery dart that the enemy throws, there is a counter word of God to deflect his missiles. The Bible said Jesus Christ, the Son of God, made himself of no reputation, became man, gave himself just for us. Amen. So I want to encourage us this afternoon, as we stand on our feet. Can you stand on your feet? Hallelujah. I want you to ponder over this. I want you to reflect over the word that you have found. What are those fiery darts that the enemy is throwing at you? What are they? You know. Yeah, they're all over the place flying. But you've got the anti-scorpion that will arrest every fairy dirt. Use the word of God, the word of faith. Use what God has placed and put in your disposal to destroy the fairy dirt. And the Lord will deliver you.
Amen.
And you have victory in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. This would have